Hello. Today I want to discuss Max Weber's concepts of charisma and the routinization of charisma. Weber's main discussion of these related concepts occurs in his section on the types of legitimate domination in his great seminal work Economy and Society, which was first published in German shortly after his death. Suffice it here to note that Weber argued that the legitimate exercise of power, authority as opposed to the mere exercise of force, requires ordinary people to accept it as valid, and that legitimacy commonly rests on some combination of three pure types of authority: tradition, rational legal grounds, and charisma. In the first part of this video, I will discuss the concept of charisma, dealing with four issues. What is charisma? The relationship between the charismatic leader and his or her followers, the revolutionary nature of charismatic authority, and the precarious nature of that authority. So, first, what is charisma? Simply put, charismatic authority rests on the recognition of a particular individual as having extraordinary or even supernatural or superhuman powers or qualities. Although Weber borrowed the term charisma from early Christian vocabulary, the charismata are the gifts of divine grace which are bestowed on individual believers by the Holy Spirit, he uses the term in a wider and value-neutral way. Those who are recognized as having charisma may indeed include religious leaders, such as prophets, holy men, shamans, and healers. But the term can also be applied to extraordinary warriors and political demagogues. Nor is there any assumption that the perceived charisma is necessarily real. Charismatic leaders may well be sincere, but they can also include gifted tricksters. The genuineness of charisma does not necessarily matter, because a key factor in all forms of charismatic authority is that it is validated by the belief and faith of the followers in the leader. In a sense, the charismatic leader only exists in the context of his or her following. Charisma is attributed by the disciples to the one they follow. Because of this essentially emotional link between the followers or devotees and the charismatic leader, we can speak of a charismatic community, whereby the followers, as well as the leader, are endowed with extraordinariness and are taken out of their everyday lives by dint of their devotion. This is particularly clear in the case of the immediate circle of the leader's chief disciples or bodyguard, who are chosen or discarded on the basis of their supposed charismatic qualities. Unlike the staff of a traditional or modern rational legal leader, they are not chosen on the basis of social privilege or official training. It is the charismatically based relationship with the leader which is important. The disciples have no demarcated career, but are rather summoned by the leader to work with him or her. Neither is a clear bureaucratic structure required. The leader intervenes as charismatic needs seem to dictate, and the specific role of each individual disciple need not be defined. In passing, let me note that Weber does not analyze why people follow charismatic leaders beyond brief comments that their devotion may be based on enthusiasm, hope, or despair, and that it may arise out of enthusiasm, suffering, or conflict. Now let me turn to the revolutionary nature of charismatic authority. For Weber, charismatic authority is a specifically revolutionary force. It is bound neither by traditional precedent, nor rational bureaucratic rules or legal principles. It is the leader who creates new obligations, whether by revelations, oracles, or his own will or inspiration, and his followers then recognize it as a duty to follow these injunctions. The leader's judgments supersede traditional beliefs and practices, as in the biblical instruction, "It is written, but I say unto you." It is therefore possible for a charismatic leader to effect a change in the established order by changing the attitude of the followers to the social situation in which they live. More generally, pure charisma is a call or mission, and as such disdains regular economic activity. Prophets and heroic warriors may well seek booty and the material means of power and prestige, but separate themselves from the everyday world of economic life. This principle is often embedded in the rules of religious orders to disdain from worldly involvements, and also in the practice of charismatic leaders and their chief disciples, who live on the basis of voluntary gifts by their followers. Finally, Weber emphasizes that charisma is always precarious. On the one hand, it derives its authority from the recognition it receives from the leader's followers, and as such may require to be periodically validated, whether by the performance of miracles, or success in battle, or other marks of supernatural prowess or favor. Correspondingly, if a leader fails to validate his or her charisma, then charismatic authority can be lost, and the leader's followers desert him or her. Prolonged lack of success is seen as a sign that the gods no longer support the leader, or that he has lost his magical or heroic powers. One perhaps unexpected example of this process concerned the traditional Chinese emperors, the basis of whose authority included a charismatic component in the form of the so-called Mandate of Heaven, which rested with the emperor when he was successful, but was deemed to have left him if his reign was marked by prolonged and significant misfortune, such as major military defeats or natural disasters. In such cases, the emperor could be forced to abdicate. More crudely, if the leadership of a particular individual doesn't in some sense benefit the followers, his authority is also likely to be lost. Again, if several charismatic leaders simultaneously claim authority, it will be necessary for them to compete, whether by magic or by battle, to determine whose charisma is genuine, the loser losing his authority. Of particular interest to Weber is the process of routinization, which he sees as fundamental to charismatic leadership, but that will require a much more detailed discussion, which will occupy the remainder of this video. For Weber, charismatic authority in its pure form only exists in its original emergent state. As such, it cannot remain stable, but must give way to either of the alternative forms of authority, or to some combination of the two. That is, it must become partly or fully traditionalized or rationalized. The reason for this inevitable transition is that by its very nature, charismatic authority is out of the everyday and set apart from routine structures, as well as being based on specific relationships with a charismatic leader and within a charismatic community. There is therefore always a pressure towards a return to the stable world of normality. This is most obvious in the case of the followers, who have real material interests in pursuing a normal family life and enjoying a secure social and economic life. Only the most enthusiastic are prepared to devote their lives to some idealistic call. The pressure towards what Weber calls routinization, the return to routine, is particularly marked following the death of a charismatic leader, when the followers must decide whether or not to follow a new leader, and if they do, how much charismatic authority to accord him. Often what develops is some system of charisma of office, as in the Roman Catholic Papacy or the Dalai Lamahood in Tibetan Buddhism. In both cases, a succession of charismatic leaders is chosen and recognized in some way. But it must be recognized that such institutions represent a weak and attenuated form of charismatic authority, which is closely bound up with particular traditional forms of authority, including specific rituals and procedures, which are followed in selecting the successor. There is also an obviously charismatic element in notions of divine kingship, or the divine right of kings, in whatever form they are followed. Here again, we are dealing with the charisma of office, represented in parts of Western Europe, for example, in rituals whereby the future king assumes office in a religiously sanctioned process, which may include ceremonies such as anointing with holy oil in recognition of taking up a charismatic role. To conclude, as Weber himself remarks, his designation of forms of authority and his description of the particular form of charismatic authority and of the process by which it is routinized are of value to the extent that they enable us to more adequately portray and analyze particular historical instances in which they are held to apply. Thank you.